The Surveyors, or Vengeur class of 74 gunships of the line, was built for the Royal Navy in the middle of the Napoleonic Wars. Britain had entered the latest in a series of prolonged conflicts with France, with the workhorse of the fleet, the 74-gun ship of the line, present in some numbers, but nowhere near enough to cover every need. Various runs of new builds and the kind donations of similar-sized vessels from the French and Spanish navies had helped, but wear and tear, combined with strandings and wrecks that were an inevitable consequence of being at sea in all weathers for prolonged periods of blockade and patrol duty in this time period, gradually worked those numbers back down again. Additionally, many of the captured ships, especially the French ones, in this rating band, were actually 80-gun vessels. On paper, these looked very good. They were larger, more heavily armed, and in many cases faster than the British 74s. But wooden shipbuilding technology was pushing the limits of what was possible prior to Seppings and Simmons' advances in the early 19th century, and these 80-gun units were less agile, and being slightly too long for their beam, tended to work themselves apart relatively quickly in heavy seas or during prolonged voyages, which meant that they required frequent stays in dock for repairs and refits. At the time, the position of Surveyor of the Navy, basically the designer, was filled by two officers. This was designed to allow competing designs to be drawn up in-house to match Admiralty requirements, as during peacetime the Royal Navy would only accept ships built in the Royal Docks, and even in wartime commercial yards were really only wanted when you had to build additional shipping that the naval yards couldn't provide. In view of all this, less than a year after Trafalgar, the Admiralty asked for designs for a small, agile, solid, and most of all cheap, 74-gun third rate that could then be issued as drawings to commercial yards for mass production. One of the surveyors, Sir William Rule, suggested a ship that was slightly smaller in all dimensions to Sir Henry Pekes, who is the other surveyor, although both ships had a very similar displacement, 1717 tons and 1766 tons respectively. The larger ship was based on a French ship, the Courageux, that had been captured some time earlier by the Royal Navy and then later lost in a storm. But, being a 74-gun vessel with a good reputation for performance, she was copied directly, or taken as a reference base point, for a number of runs of third rates up until this point. After spending the summer deliberating, the Admiralty returned with a third set of specifications, demanding a ship as long as the larger design, but with the thinner beam of the smaller ship, a draft of a hybrid, and gun ports as high from the waterline as the larger design, all on the displacement of the smaller design. Needless to say, this represented something of an ungainly kludge of hybrid design elements, but orders were orders, and so, with some apparent behind-the-scenes minor alterations from the surveyors in an attempt to fit the design with reality, the drawings were prepared and dispatched to the numerous commercial yards across the UK. At 176 feet long, the ships mounted a lower gun deck battery of 28 32-pounders, an upper gun deck battery of 28 18-pounders, with a quarter deck battery of 4 12-pounders and 10 32-pounder carronades, a forecastle battery of 2 12-pounders and 2 32-pounder carronades, and a poop deck armament of 6 18-pounder carronades, rendering it quite heavily armed for the standards of a 74-gun ship, at least at close range. A few years later, the ships began to enter service, but commercial shipyards, as with much of the shipbuilding industry at the time, were rife with corruption, and the Navy contracts in particular were seen as easy targets because at the end of the day, in the middle of a war, the Navy needed those ships yesterday and the government would rather just get their ships out and into action as opposed to delay their entry into service by arguing over the bill. And of course, once you had their money, if the government disputed it later on, it was much harder for anyone to try and take it back. The class became informally known as the 40 Thieves after the Arabian tale of the same name, due to the order of 40 ships and the many reports from various naval officers of substandard materials, such as one claiming in wonderful turn of the 18th to 19th century English that the ships were made of 20-year-old wood and green stuff all clapped together promiscuous and fastened with copper, precious little copper, and then overmasted to please a landman's fancy, so that when it comes on to blow her timbers, all sprawl about. In more modern English, what he was saying was that the ships used a mixture of seasoned old and fresh wood thrown in together haphazardly, whereas if you were making that kind of hybrid construction, you should at least try to build it in distinct sections of different types of wood. They were also fastened together largely with copper nails instead of using wooden pegs or trenails, copper nails being more vulnerable to work loose and would also degrade faster at sea, and on top of that they were apparently used very sparingly. The masts, rigging and sails looked very impressive, but they were too much and too heavy for the ship, and this meant that when a strong wind blew, the ship's own propulsion mechanism would start to pull the ship apart. And for all this, the costs mysteriously skyrocketed. You can understand, then, the nickname. Nevertheless, they did represent a lot of ships. Two small fleets worth of ships of the line, in fact. And 35 of the 40 would be complete before the end of the war in 1815, with the last five completing afterwards. 29 were built in commercial yards, and 11 in naval dockyards. However, their reputation for generally poor build quality and high cost was compounded by the fact that they started arriving in 1809, which was after when most of the battles had already been fought, and this left them somewhat sparse on battle honours compared with older and more battered veteran ships. However, the Navy dockyard ships and some of the commercial vessels, as well as some of the others after they'd been refitted, eventually turned out to be relatively durable, and because of their relative lack of action, they lasted a fairly long time in service. A couple of decades after the first of their number set sail, 10 of them were razed down to 50-gun frigates, followed by an 11th, which was an earlier incarnation of HMS Warspite, a decade later still. Lastly, about 35 years after the first hull sailed into service, more of this class were turned into steam-powered 60-gun block ships, with some of them even seeing action in this guise in the Crimean War. And one of them, HMS Blenheim, was our guide through the sail to steam video.
That's it for this video. Thanks for watching. If you have a comment or suggestion for a ship to review, let us know in the comments below. Don't forget to comment on the pinned post for dry dock questions.